Thank you for choir and orchestra and Tommy and team for leading us in that. And thank you for, because by the way, you are a part of the choir. We're all a part of the choir. They're just leading us. We get to sing with them. And I want to remind you that in eternity, we'll be a part of a choir. And if you think that was something, man, the choir in eternity is going to be even better. So let's turn our attention now to God's Word. Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1. We finished up a series last week called Every Story is God's Story, just seeing the genealogy of Jesus and the way it leads us to this moment that we're celebrating called Christmas. Today we're shifting gears a little bit, starting a new series called Unwrapped, and it's revealing the mystery of Christmas. So the idea is that Christmas present that you have, that you walk by and you wonder what's in it, and you kind of shake it around and you poke and prod a little bit and you listen to see what's in it. Well, what the New Testament does for us is it unwraps that gift for us, and we get to understand exactly what we were given in Christmas. So we have a present here today, and I need a volunteer. Is there somebody who would help me with this present? Just the first person that is willing to help me with this present. So anybody? Oh, we got one right there. Come on. Yeah, you can come up. Now, what's your name? All right. Now, have we ever met before? Yeah. We have? Okay, well, anyway. All right. Would you open this present for us? Now, I want to be clear. You don't get to keep this present. This is just to help us set our minds on the message for today. We'll open one this week, one next week, and one on the 22nd that'll help remind us. You have lost your present opening skills. You're usually better than this. All right, thank you. And the wrapping paper is yours to keep. Now, what is this?
Pillow.
A pillow. Is it just any pillow?
No.
What kind of pillow is it?
A Christmas pillow.
A Christmas pillow. All right. Thank you, Meredith. Can y'all thank Meredith for her help here? So this is a Christmas pillow. I'm going to put this right here. Over the next couple of weeks, we'll add a few things to this. And this is just a visual way to remind us. Today, we're going to look in a passage of Scripture where Joseph has a dream. God uses five dreams in the birth narratives about Jesus in the book of Matthew to speak to people, mainly to Joseph. And today, we're going to see the first of those dreams. And then next week and the week after, we'll open some other gifts that will help point our hearts and our minds towards what God is saying to us in His Word. And I want this pillow to remind us that Joseph was just going about the normal course of life. Now, it was a particular bumpy part of the normal course of life. He had been engaged and found out in the middle of his engagement that his wife was expecting a child that he knew was not his own. So it's not that it was normal in the sense of, well, just get up and go to work and come home and nothing really changes. But it was normal in this sense. Pain in relationships is a normal part of our experience in a fallen world. So it is not shocking to us that in a fallen world, a young man and young woman are engaged to be married, and the young woman comes to be found out to be with child, and it is not that of the father. That is something that, as a regular occurrence, is a normal part. In other words, it's a very natural part of living in a sin-cursed world. And so Joseph is going about the normal course of his life, but in that, God intersects the normal course of Joseph's life with a dream, and he does it in order to accomplish through the Holy Spirit his plan through Jesus. In fact, I want to say it this way. This is what I want you to focus your hearts on as we go through God's Word together. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, God the Father intersects the normal course of life to accomplish his great plan in Jesus. If you see in that all three persons of the Trinity, that's intentional. And as we read this passage, I want you to be aware that as is often the case, although the Bible does not say, here is the chapter that tells us about the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. There is no chapter in the Bible that teaches us everything we need to know about the Trinity. The doctrine of the Trinity is woven throughout all of Scripture, and it is here in Matthew chapter 1. So as we read, I want you to notice that God the Father is at work through the power of the Holy Spirit in bringing the Son, Jesus, to earth. Matthew chapter 1, I'm going to start reading in verse 18. The Bible says this, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. After her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Take a moment for a pause right there, and let me point out this verse, the power of this verse. You will call his name Jesus, for he will save the people from their sins. That we're not going to talk about that verse today, but just to do a little bit of a commercial on December the 22nd on our Christmas service, an opportunity when you have to invite friends and family to come that might not come at other times of the year. I'm going to be speaking from that verse, what the angel actually said about Jesus and what the prophets had actually said about Jesus. So don't miss December 22nd. It'll be a great opportunity for those who don't know Christ to be introduced to who Jesus really was. Verse 22. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from his sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for your word. Lord, would you fill me with your spirit? God, would you open our hearts to what you had to say to us? And Lord, I pray that your word would accomplish its intended purpose. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So this passage, as you're reading, verse 18, you see a shift, especially if you've been with us for the last 3 weeks. There's a sort of a break in the pattern. We have such and such was the father of such and so on, and down through the genealogy of Jesus. And then we come to verse 18, and in verse 18 we have this. Now, and look, here we go. The birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. So it's a shift in gears for Matthew. Let's get into the story of the birth of Jesus in this moment. But it's not as much of a shift as it is a shift in the narrative piece as it is in the focus. Because if you look back to that very opening verse of Matthew, the book of the genealogy, the book of the beginning, that word is a really interesting word. It can mean a lot of different things. And it's translated genealogy in most of our English Bibles in verse 1. And then that same word is translated the birth of Jesus Christ in verse 18. In other words, what Matthew is telling us is there's a connection. There's a connection between these two sections of Scripture. He's saying in that first section of Scripture, verses 1 through 17, I'm giving you the beginnings, the coming to be of the Messiah from the perspective of who his people are. But now in verse 18, I'm going to shift gears a little bit, and I want to give you the beginning, the coming to be, the birth of, the coming to earth of the Messiah from the miraculous supernatural part. So we might look at it this way. Jesus is Son of Man and Son of God. Verses 1 through 17 tell us he is indeed the Son of Man. He is a human. Beginning in verse 18, we're going to find out that Jesus is human, but he is no mere human. He is fully God and he is fully man. And we're going to see through the virgin birth, the virgin conception, and the Holy Spirit's work that we have the incarnation of Jesus, fully God and fully man. So the birth of Jesus took place in this way. It's the same thought Paul had in mind in Romans chapter 1 when he says it this way. Jesus was descended from David according to the flesh. That would be verses 1 through 17. And he was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness. That would be beginning in verse 18. So we see this shift that takes place where the Trinity at work, the Father making a declaration to send the Son through the power of the Spirit. We see that at work. And by the way, that's how the Trinity always works. God declares, God says this, God the Father says this is how it will be. And I'm going to do my work, I'm going to accomplish my work through God the Son. It's going to be God the Son who carries out my plan. But it's going to be God the Spirit who empowers that plan. And we see this all the way from the very beginning. In the beginning, it was God the Father who spoke. But then we find out in the New Testament that he did all of that through Jesus Christ, that Jesus Christ was the agent carrying out the very act of creation. And then we know from Genesis chapter 1 that it was the power of the Spirit that was there at work. So we see this all throughout our Bibles. And so that's why today what I've said is that through the power of the Holy Spirit, God the Father intersects the normal course of life to accomplish his great plan in Jesus. We see that here in Matthew chapter 1. The question is, how? How do we see it in Matthew 1? How does this work out? Well, there are at least three ways there in Matthew chapter 1. The first way I want you to see it is this, that the Holy Spirit, He fulfills God's Word. He fulfills God's Word. The entire point of Matthew's telling of this is to come to this point where he can say to us that all of this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken through the prophet. In other words, all this happened, the virgin birth, the virgin conception, the dream and the angel, all this happened in order to fulfill God's preordained, pre-proclaimed plan. God ordained it, planned it before the foundation of the world. He spoke it centuries earlier through Isaiah the prophet, and now he is bringing it about through the work of his Son and through the power of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is always at work fulfilling the Word of God. That tells us a couple of things. First, it tells us that anyone who says to you, well, the Holy Spirit told me, or they might say, well, God led me, but you look in here and you say, you know, I just don't see that in here. They might be being led by a spirit, but they're not being led by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit of God fulfills God's Word. There is nothing that the Holy Spirit will ever do or ever lead anyone else to do that is in any way outside of the pages of this Word. It means that. It also means that He fills up or He fully fills. I want you to think about that word fulfilled for just a moment. And I want to give you two pictures. The first is of a bucket. Imagine you have a bucket, 5-gallon bucket. You're out in the backyard. You might be filling it with dirt or filling it with gravel or filling it with leaves or whatever you're filling it with. And you say, well, I filled the bucket with some leaves. And that might mean that it's maybe halfway full. But what the word fulfilled means is you fulfill it. You fill it fully. You put the dirt in and you press it down. You put a little more dirt in, you press it down. I mean, you get that thing to where it's just brimming over the top, being full. And then you can say, well, this is a fully filled bucket. And in case you say, well, I don't really do a lot of work in the yard, I want to either take you back a couple of weeks or move you forward a couple of weeks to a moment where you're going to say, you know, I just could not eat another bite. And then someone says, well, you know, there's dessert. Well, you know, I think some room just opened up. I thought I was full, but now I'm going to eat dessert and I'm going to be fully filled. And so now I'm fully filled. I thought I was full, but then something came along that helped me understand. There was a little more to the story than I knew about. My mother-in-law and father-in-law are here today. Dave and Faye Roberts are here with us for the weekend. They come because they like to hear me preach. Has nothing to do with the little angels who were up here singing earlier. They just come to town from time to time to hear me preach. But when Lindsay and I first started dating, I would go over to their house, and I was a starving college kid, and so anything they put on the table, I would eat, and her mom is a fantastic cook, and then I would just, and she'd say, do you want seconds? I want seconds. Do you want thirds? Yes. Do you want it to go bag? Yes. You know, I was a college student. And so I would eat and eat and eat and eat. And then it never failed. She would say, and now comes dessert. And so we had a little joke going for a while. And I would say, listen, before the meal begins, I need to know the dessert situation. I need to know if you need me to save out room for dessert. Because if not, I'm going to eat till I'm fully filled. Well, I hope that you, as you enjoy time with family over the next couple of weeks, that you think about this idea of being fully filled, that you think everything is full. You think it's all done. And then here comes something that causes you to say, I just thought I was full. Because that's the way, specifically with this passage, that the Holy Spirit fills up or fully fills God's Word. Here's what I mean by that. There's 5 times in chapters 1 and 2 that the Bible says that this was done to fulfill what the Lord had spoken through the prophet. And most of the time, what God is telling us in Matthew's gospel is that there was something we thought had already been fulfilled. So the Bible says, out of Egypt I called my son. And the Bible, that is fulfilled in the Old Testament. The Jewish people come out of Egypt. But what we find out in the New Testament is that that was just a sign. It was a reminder of what God was going to do with his own son, Jesus, when he would go to Egypt to flee from Herod's wrath. And then he would come back and he would be called out of Egypt. So we find out, wow, there was something more to that passage than we thought. Well, the same is true of this passage. Behold, the virgin shall be with child. It's given to us in Isaiah chapter 7. It's fulfilled in Isaiah's day. Isaiah is walking along and the word of God comes to him and says, behold, the virgin, meaning in that context, the young woman of marriable age, she will be with child, and that's going to be a sign for you. So that sign is fulfilled. The child is born, Isaiah's own child, and it becomes a sign for the Jewish people, and God does what he says he's going to do. But here's what we did not know then that we know now. That child, as the Bible says, was a sign. In other words, it was a sign of something later to come. We thought it was as full as it could get. But here comes the Messiah. And Matthew tells us, and make no mistake, what Matthew is saying is not that a young woman of marrying age will be with child. He is clearly saying that a virgin, someone who's never been with a man, will be with child. He makes that clear in his word choice, and he makes it clear in the context of the passage. But he says, this is going to be fulfilled in an even greater way. You just thought it was full, but now we're going to see that God was doing something even more in Isaiah and the birth of his child. He was pointing forward to the birth of Jesus himself. He fulfills God's word. The first way that the Holy Spirit accomplishes God's plan is that he fulfills God's word. Second way is this. God, the Holy Spirit, he uses faithful servants. One of the intriguing parts of the Christmas story is all the people, different people from different walks of life, different backgrounds. We have the wise men, and we have the shepherds, and we have Mary, and we love to read about the faithfulness of Mary. But Joseph draws our attention. Matthew draws our attention to Joseph. More than any other telling of the Christmas story, we're drawn to the story of Joseph in Matthew. And Matthew tells us some things about Joseph that we didn't know. He tells us about this dream that he has, where Joseph is in a very difficult situation. And we can understand the difficulty of his situation. He's engaged, and by the way, he wasn't really engaged. He was actually married to Mary. He was betrothed to her. The contract was signed. Everything was done. The marriage just had not been consummated. There was a one-year waiting period before they would consummate the marriage. But in every other way, other than living in the same household and consummating the marriage, they were married in every legal sense of the way, so that it would take a divorce for them to be separated. And so they were married in every sense of the word. And then he finds out that she is expecting a child, and he knows it's not his. So here are the options that he has. He can go through with the marriage. If he goes through with the marriage, everyone will assume it's his child. He's shamed. He loses his honor. He loses his status. Or he can separate from her. And if he separates from her, he still loses his honor. He still loses his status. In other words, people will say of Joseph, well, there was that man whose family wasn't really good at choosing a bride for him. And he'll lose honor. And in that day, honor was everything. Honor was your social status. It was also your economic status. Remember, Joseph was a carpenter. It determined whose carpenter work he would do. His honor and his shame did. So if you didn't want to be shamed along with Joseph, then you certainly didn't want to call him to your home to be the carpenter who works in your home. So there was a lot on the line for Joseph. And this is a difficult situation. And we know from the text that Joseph acts faithfully. The Bible says he was a just man in his actions. He was a just man as he considered what to do, and he was a just man as he decided to put her away quietly. Of course, everything changes when the angel comes to him, and he becomes not only a just and righteous man, but a submissive man who hears this is of God, and God has commanded me to do something. That makes the decision for him. And from that moment forward, Joseph is committed completely, and he serves as a faithful adopted father. So those of you who work in foster care, those of you who have adopted children, Joseph is a beautiful model of that. Those of you also who serve as step-parents and have gone through the difficulty of that, Joseph is a great model for this. What is it like to raise a child who you know is not biologically yours, but you love them just as much? Well, this is what Joseph did. And there are different challenges that come along with that. And there's a different level and different type of faithfulness. The Holy Spirit works through faithful servants. It's not just Joseph that God wants to use through the Holy Spirit as a faithful servant. It's all of us. We know from the New Testament, from beginning to end, that God's Spirit comes not to one person or one follower of Christ, but to all followers of Christ. And he brings gifts. In fact, he brings gifts to us that he gives to us that aren't really ours. He gives them to us, and they actually belong to the church. And it's our job to take the gift that God has given us and use it in service to the church, to be faithful with what God has given us, because the gift doesn't belong to them. It would be the very same as if I were going out of town for Christmas. Maybe I was called away for some emergency and I wasn't going to be with my family on Christmas Day, and I came to you and I said, please, I'm not going to be able to be with my family on Christmas Day, but I've gotten them all gifts. Would you make sure that you drop by my family's house and give them these gifts to them so that they have the gifts that I wanted them to have on Christmas Day as I'm called away to an emergency? and you load them up in your car, you drive them straight to your house, and you open them up, and you enjoy them, and there sits my family on Christmas Day without my gifts. I would never do that, Pastor. Listen, your gift is not yours. Your gift is given to you to be used by God in service to the kingdom. So this is what 1 Peter 4:10 says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as God's good stewards of his varied grace. God has given you a gift, but it doesn't actually belong to you. It's been entrusted to you to steward it, to use for the good of his kingdom and the service of others. So God uses faithful servants. He calls, he fulfills his word, he uses faithful servants. I want to take just a moment and on a side note, because I don't believe we can go through this passage without addressing this particular issue. I want to speak for a moment about the issue of divorce. Now, my desire is not to get into a theology of divorce as to when someone should or should not divorce, but I just want to speak for a moment about Joseph in this particular moment. Because the Bible says something very interesting about Joseph. It says that being a just man, in verse 19, being a just or righteous man, he resolved to divorce her. So he made a decision. He had a difficult decision to make. By the way, it was not a decision he made easily. The Bible says while he was considering these things, while he was thinking about these things, that's when the angel came to him in a dream. So this was weighing heavy on his heart. He didn't know if it was the right thing to do or not. The reason that I say that is over the years, as couples have come into the office, and even when someone's cheated, one person's cheated on the other, my response has always been the same. If you are both willing to save this marriage, to see this marriage saved, then that is God's will for this marriage. The best option is that this marriage stay together, no matter how deep and dark the sin, no matter how deep and dark the betrayal. If this can be worked out, if there's repentance and forgiveness, let's see if we can work this marriage out. I don't believe that divorce is ever the first option. In fact, early in my ministry, I had somebody come into my office, and it was a husband and wife, and the husband had cheated on the wife. They'd been married for about a year, and the husband had cheated on her six different times with different ladies. And even sitting across the desk as the pastor, I thought, there's no way this will work. This won't work out. Six times in a year? And my goodness, what is going on here? But as we got into the root of it and we uncovered the unconfessed sin there, and there was real repentance and there was real forgiveness, God restored that marriage to the point that now that marriage is 15 years strong. And the man repented of his sexual sin, and he became a counselor for those who are also stuck in sexual sin. And so even in that moment where you go, well, there's no way God can restore this marriage. Divorce is not our first option. But there are moments, we read it right here, where a just and righteous person will go through divorce. But that's not really where I want to land. When is it wrong or right? And when is it just or unjust to go through a divorce? Here's what I want you to see. Do you see that Joseph was a just man for two reasons? He resolved to divorce her. He decided that that was the most just course of action in that particular moment, until he found out otherwise from the angel, of course. But then also because he was just specifically, it wasn't that he was unjust. He was not unjust for resolving to divorce her. So in other words, he didn't make him unrighteous that in this moment he thought the best thing to do, best course of action was divorce. But what really made him actually just and righteous in this situation is that he resolved to divorce her quietly, and he was unwilling to put her to shame. Now listen. It's hard to know in some situations who's right and who's wrong in a divorce. In fact, most of the time, there's blame on both sides. But in this situation, we know that had the angel not intervened, that Joseph would have been a just man. Why? Because the Bible tells us. But even in that moment, when Joseph had all the right and all the righteousness and all the justice on his side, the just thing for him to do was not to put her to public shame. Here's what I want to share with you, because I know divorce has touched every family in this congregation. Every family sitting in this room, including my own, has been touched by divorce. There is a tendency in divorce, when spouses divorce, to not say, well, how can I keep from putting my spouse, my ex-spouse, to public shame? Actually, the tendency is exactly the opposite. How can I put my spouse, my ex-spouse, who hurt me, who did this to me, who did that to me, how can I put them to the most possible public shame? How can I win the favor in my family? How can it be, and Christmas is coming up, so that when I walk into the family gathering at Christmas, everybody sides with me and not with him or her? How can it be so that on Facebook, when all of our high school friends are watching this divorce happen, how can it be that they understand that they were the ones who wronged me and I was not the ones who wronged him? How can I put my spouse to the most public shame possible so that somehow I will get ahead in all of this? That's the tendency. And I want to encourage you. In fact, I want to exhort you, warn you from this text, and we could go to many others, that that is not the way a righteous man or a righteous woman or a just man or a just woman would approach that situation. But pastor, I have the right. Between services, I had several people come to me and tell me they've been through this very issue. But one man in particular said, you know, I held on to my anger against my wife. And pastor, it was her. She was the one in the wrong. I held on to my anger against my wife. And I lost 25 pounds. And it wasn't the 25 good pounds you want to lose. 25 pounds. Up until the moment when I released that anger. And the moment I released that anger, I felt a weight come off of me. Because what I did is I gave up the right to publicly shame and to hold against my wife what she had done to me. I know in this room there are people who are struggling with that very thing. That right that you feel that you have to publicly shame someone or within your family to shame someone. And here's what I want to say to you as a pastor. I want to warn you from God's word that that's a sin against God. But as a pastor, I want to shepherd you in this way. Whatever you're looking for, whatever you think you're going to find in that tearing down of your spouse to build yourself up, it's not there. Whatever fulfillment you think is going to come. And this doesn't have to be divorce, by the way. This might be students. This might be your high school sweetheart breaks up with you, or someone shames you, or you go on even one date with somebody and they're running you down. You feel like, well, I have a right. I want to get mine in. I want my people to know. I want to publicly shame them. Whatever it is that you're looking for, you will not find it there. God has designed the universe in such a way that where you're actually going to find it is in forgiveness, letting it go, and stepping away from your right to publicly shame them and to hold this against them. That's where you're going to find what you're looking for. Joseph, being a just man, resolved to divorce her quietly and was unwilling to put her to public shame. So we've seen two ways God uses the Holy Spirit. First, the Holy Spirit fulfills God's word. Secondly, the Holy Spirit uses faithful servants. Third, the Holy Spirit creates new life. This is really an amazing moment in Scripture. The miracle of the virgin birth was brought about by the Holy Spirit. That moment when God became man, that moment when human flesh was combined with the very essence of God Himself. It's brought about by the power of the Holy Spirit. Twice in this passage, we read about the Holy Spirit's role. Verse 18, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Verse 20, that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. This is vitally important for our understanding of God's word, so much so that many people have attacked this point. If you want to see where the hinges of Christian theology hang, if you want to know what passages in Scripture, of course, all Scripture is God's word. It's God-inspired, God-breathed from Genesis 1:1 all the way to the end of Revelation 22. It's all God's word. But if you want to see those passages that are those hinge passages or even those foundational passages, just look to see where the enemy attacks. Because the enemy knows that there are ideas and there are theologies that if he can take away the exclusivity of Christ, if he can take away the exclusivity of Christ, he can destroy the church. If he can take away creation and the fact that God spoke creation into existence, he can destroy the church. And Satan knows that if he can take away our belief in the virgin birth of Jesus Christ, that he can destroy the church. That's why Satan has attacked this so vehemently. And he has attacked it vehemently. But here's what I want you to know. We have not made up the idea of the virgin birth in the 21st or the 20th century. We didn't come up with that idea. It is right here in Matthew's gospel. And you cannot honestly read Matthew's gospel without reading that Matthew is telling us that Jesus was born of a virgin, not a young woman of marrying age, as the Hebrew word could mean, but a young woman who had never been intimately with a man. He's very clear about that, both in Matthew's account and in the account that we're given in Luke. And then it's encoded into our earliest statements of faith. The Apostles' Creed, we don't know when it was written, but it was written somewhere around the turn of the first century. Very shortly after the Bible was finished, we put into words as a church, here's what we believe. Here's the foundation of what we believe. And we included this statement. We said, I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. And then we as a denomination, the Southern Baptist Convention, said it's important to us in Matthew chapter 1. It's important to us at the turn of the first century. And it's important to us even in 2019. We have encoded it into our own statement of faith. From the Baptist Faith and Message, it reads this way. Christ is the eternal Son of God. In His incarnation as Jesus Christ, He was conceived of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. Pastor, what does dusty old theology have to do with us this morning? There's an all-out assault and attack on Jesus. And the world is okay with a Jesus who was not born of a virgin, who did not die an atoning death, and who was not raised to eternal life. The world's okay with that Jesus. But the world is not okay with the God-man, God Himself, taking on flesh, living a perfect life, dying a sinless death in my place and in your place for our sin, our rebellion against God. They are not okay with the idea that our sin garnered the punishment that was given out on the cross, and they are not okay with a Messiah that was raised from the dead on the third day to eternal life. They're not okay with that. So it's important that we say as a church, we believe in it all. If it says it, we believe it. We believe that Jesus was born and conceived of a virgin. Still important to us in 2019. The Spirit creates new life. You know, that's what He's always done. That's always been His role. The Father proclaims and the Spirit empowers. And they do it through the work of the Son. We can go all the way back to creation. Genesis chapter 1 verse 2. The Bible says, In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and void. And the darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. There was the Spirit of God getting ready. And just that moment before light comes and before life comes, there is the Spirit of God active in creation. Then, in this passage, we see that it was the Spirit of God who miraculously brought new life in a way that the world had never seen. Life, every life is miraculous, every life is special, but this life, the life of Jesus, was different. This was an infusing of the essence of God with the genetic DNA of mankind, so that the two had never been joined together and the two would never be separated. Jesus became fully God and fully man in that moment, and He is still fully God and fully man, and He'll be fully God and fully man for all of eternity. And that took place through the work of the Holy Spirit. But then, just a few short years later, the Bible tells us in the book of Romans that it was the power of the Spirit, Romans chapter 8, verse 11, that raised Jesus from the dead. In other words, as Jesus' lifeless body lay there in that tomb, something new happened. See, it wasn't new that anyone had been raised from the dead. I want to encourage you sometime when you're reading through the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, I want to encourage you to make note of every funeral Jesus attends, because they all have something in common. Jesus ruins every funeral He ever attends. Because Jesus never met a dead person at a funeral that He did not raise from the dead. Jesus goes to the funeral and everybody's sad over a dead person, and Jesus gets there, there's no more dead person to be sad over. Jesus just has a way of ruining a good funeral. But I want you to see that those people, yes, were raised from the dead as others were raised from the dead. Even in the Hebrew Scriptures, we have record of people being raised from the dead, but they were raised from the dead to die again. In other words, they weren't raised with an eternal resurrection body. They were raised to show who Jesus was in the Hebrew Scriptures, to show the power of Almighty God, that God was at work. That's why they were raised. But Jesus was raised for a different reason. Jesus was raised as the first person to be raised from the dead to eternal life. Something new was happening. Jesus' dead body was being raised to be an eternal body that would live forevermore and never die again. And in that moment, the Spirit of God comes into the tomb and empowers that body. And Jesus' dead body is raised from the grave. The Spirit is always at work creating new life. By the way, He does it in unexpected places. Who would ever expect that a dark and formless place, the chaos of the preformed and pre-shaped universe, who would ever expect that out of that we would have something as wonderful as light and life? Who would ever expect that this young girl from Bethlehem that no one knew about, from Nazareth that no one knew about, who would ever expect that in the womb of that unknown, unseen young woman, God would do something new, create new life? Who would ever expect that in the dead body of a Jewish rabbi that God would do something new and would create this eternal body that would never die and bring us eternal life? God does it where we don't expect it. And that becomes important for us in this room because of what John chapter 3 says. John chapter 3 tells us that just as the Spirit of God was at work in creation creating new life, just as the Spirit of God was at work there in Mary creating new life and raising Jesus from the dead, that it takes the Holy Spirit of God to give us new life. Listen to John chapter 3. Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus, who Jesus is speaking to, has a question. How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water," that's a reference to physical birth, "unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Jesus said, the Spirit of God is required to give you new life. You know what that means? That means you can't come to God on your own terms. That means you can't say, as I've heard so many people say throughout my ministry, "One of these days, I'll get right with God. After I've done what I want to do, after I've lived the life that I want to live." By the way, when you say that, you know what you don't understand? You don't understand the life you want to live is right here. The life you want to live is the life with God. It's what God's trying to give you. But for some reason, in our rebellious, sinful hearts, we think that the life we want to live is out there somewhere, and God's trying to take it from us. But for so many people who said, "Well, when I'm finished doing what I want to do, when I get a little older, when I've sowed my wild oats, when my kids are a little older, when this or when that, then I'll come and get right with God." You do not come to God on your own terms. You come to God on God's terms. And God says, without the Spirit of God, you cannot even make a decision to come to Christ. In fact, He says it this way: the wind blows wherever it wants to blow, so it is with the Spirit of God. In other words, if you think you can control the Spirit of God, try controlling the wind. The wind does whatever it wants to do, goes wherever it wants to go. So it is with the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit of God does whatever He wants to do, whenever He wants to do it, however He wants to do it. That's what it means to be God. And so the Spirit of God is the one who wakens our hearts to life and gives us, calls us, draws us. Jesus said it this way: no one can come to me unless the Spirit draws him. That new life can't begin without the Spirit of God. That's why it's so important, if you're in a room like this hearing a message from the Word of God and the Spirit of God speaks to your heart, it's so important that you respond. It's so important that you say, "Yes, yes, I'm in. I want to be a part of it. I want to repent of my sins. I want to turn from my sin and place my faith in you." It's so important that that happens, because it cannot happen without the Spirit of God bringing you to new life. He creates new life. This morning, I don't know where you stand with God, but my prayer this morning, as it is every week, is that God would awaken you. God would work in your heart through the power of the Holy Spirit to bring you to new life. I cannot make that happen in you, and you cannot make that happen in you. You say, "Well, Pastor, I'll decide when I'm ready." You know what you're saying? I'm God. I'm in control. I'm in charge. I decide. And that's the ultimate sin. In fact, it's the root of every sin. In big ways and small ways, we want to be God. We want to be in control. Sometimes we want to be in control by being the leader of a nation that takes over the world and rules the whole world, and we want everything to go our way. But sometimes we just want to be in control over the small things. But big ways and small ways, whether it's our emotions or the way our families function or the way that our marriage goes or the way that our children are raised or whatever it is, we want to be in control of all that. And we want to grab control of that, and we want to say, my way, it's my way. And that's high rebellion against a holy God. And when we come to God, what we say to Him is, God, not my way, but your way. I let go, I surrender, I give in. And I want you to understand that the Spirit of God works in conjunction with the Word of God. So that if you're here today and you've heard the Word of God and the Spirit of God is speaking to you, then He is drawing you to surrender and to give in and to be saved. Would you bow your heads?